So the NHL is a league of momentum. If the coaches don't motivate the players, they have no momentum. If the coaches over-motivate the players, they have momentum, but it's not sustained. It's got to be just right. Now, a case in point was this squad, probably one of the better teams in the 1970s to not win a Stanley Cup, I mean, one-year situation. The Chicago Blackhawks of 73-74 seemed to be poised for a pure Stanley Cup run. They had made it to the Stanley Cup Finals against Montreal in 71-73, only to lose in 7 and 6 games respectively. But by the 1973-74 season, with a squad that was backstopped by the great Tony Esposito, with Dennis Hull, Stan Mikita, Cliff Coral, Pick Martin, Chico Mackey, all the role players being in place, you would think that the longtime Western Division champions would reign supreme. Well, the season went as expected. Most of the playoffs went as expected until they met the big bad Bruins in the second round. Now, the Blackhawks' 74 campaign was their 48th season in the NHL. Now, they were coming off their fourth straight first-place finish in 72-73. They had finished that season with a 42-27-9 record with 93 points. Now, they knocked out St. Louis and the Rangers in the postseason before falling to the Habs in 6 games in the final. Now, the 1974 season was a rough one to start with for Chicago. They only had a 2-4-4 record in the first 10 games. From there, the club went on a 9-game unbeaten streak to push themselves over the 500 mark, and it was nothing but success for the rest of the season. Now, they had battled with the Flyers all season long for the top spot in the West Division, but in numerous key ties in the second half of the season drew away points, and he finished with a record of 41-13-14-23 with 105 points in the standings, just a few back of the Flyers. Now, this was the third highest total in club history. Now, the Flyers ended up with 112 points, which puts them second place overall. But get this, the 14 losses by Chicago was the fewest by the team in one season, while the 23 ties you recorded was a new team record. Now, you look at the rough stats for Chicago. They only lost 3 games after late January. They had lost back-to-back games to the Islanders and the Canadiens on the 26th and the 27th. And from then on, only lost February 24th, March 7th, and March 20th. And of course, 2 of those games were by one goal, while the other was second. So they went relatively undefeated from then on. But really stood out for me, ladies and gentlemen, because of the play of Tony Esposito and Mike Visor, from February 2nd to February 20th of that year, they had notched quite a few shutouts. They knocked out St. Louis 3-0 on February 3rd, the Flames on February 8th, 3-0 as well. They knocked off the Kings 4-0 on the 13th. The next game, they knocked off the Islanders 4-0, and then knocked off the Golden Seals on February 20th. So things were going quite well. Now, we talked about Tony Esposito. He won the Vezina Trophy that year for the lowest goals against average over 70 games. Visor didn't have enough contests, but he might as well say he was a big part of that because he went undefeated in 10 games. Now, Chicago did not have a captain that year, but of course Stan Mikita led the way yet again with a club-high 50 assists and 80 points, while Jim Pappin led the team in goals with 32 and finished with 73 points overall. Pitt Martin also scored 30 goals, while Dennis Hull at 29. Now on defense, the great Dick Redmond emerged as offensive leader with 59 points, while Bill White recorded 36 points while having a team high plus 51. Now the young Phil Russell had 10 goals and 35 points and led the team in penalty minutes with 184. Now, I talked about Esposito. He led the club with 35 wins with a 2.04 goals against average, and he had 10 shutouts while appearing in 70 games. Visor went 7-0-2 with a 2.23 goals against average. Now, because they tied with the Flyers for least goals overall, they shared the Vezina again between Esposito and Parra. Now, the Hawks opened the playoffs against the Kings, who had a mediocre 33-33-12 record for 78 points. Now, the 1-2 first games at Chicago by 3-1 and 4-1 counts to take a 2-0 series lead. Now, when the series shifted to form, The Hawks continue to shut down the Kings, winning 1-0 in Game 3. Now, the Kings won Game 4-5-1, but Esposito had another one-out shutout in Game 5 to give Chicago the series. Now, you're thinking all the momentum's on Chicago's side, because playing Boston, the first-place finishers on the other side was an opponent they knew quite well. Now, the first two games opened up at Boston Garden, and Chicago struck first, doubling the Bruins 4-2 in the series opener. Now, Boston outscored and made 6 in Game 2 to tie series. Now, in Game 3, they defeated Boston 4-3 in overtime to take a go-ahead in the series. However, the Bruins rebounded, winning the fourth game 5-2 to even the series. The fifth game was back in Boston, and the Bruins took their first series lead, dominating Chicago by a score of 8-2, and then he won 4-2 on home ice to wrap up the season against Chicago. Now, let's put this in perspective as well here, and no kidding. Chicago never lost 3 consecutive games all season. They had lost back-to-back games on the first and the third to the Flyers in Minnesota, and January 26th and 27th to Montreal and the Islanders. So, talking about losing momentum, that's what they lost momentum for sure. Now, Mikita was big in the playoffs with 11 points in 11 games, and this was kind of a denouement for Chicago. They drafted a lot of top prospects, including Rhoda, Thomas, and Randy Holt, but unfortunately, Chicago, their legacy kind of peaked. We don't really talk about this, but I will. There was an unofficial Chicago dynasty between the mid-1960s with Bobby Hull and going through all the Mikita years. They're always number 2 or number 3 team in the league and never won the Stanley Cup. But like I said, Montreal and Boston stopped them in a few of their quests. But Esposito moving over from Montreal was a big factor in that late 60s, early 70s success. Dennis Hull as well. Dennis picked up the slack for his brother from his brother, but the strong play of Bill White. And don't forget, Chicago lost Pat Stapleton. That was a big loss as well. And, you know, it was a... I know Chicago fans look back with that era with fondness, because, again, 2-0 against Montreal in Game 7 in 71. Lemaire scored a big shot, like he told me. I thought it just shooter might go in, and it did. 76, where basically Chicago had the offense, but the Frank Mahovlich, Yvonne Cormier, Montreal Canadiens, LaFleur wasn't a factor. They outshot Chicago. And why I'm saying this with this year, ladies and gentlemen, Chicago had a very beautiful plus-minus this year. They only gave up 164 goals, scored 272, so they're plus 108. So, but that really messed them up, though, those 23 ties. Because back then, teams literally would play for a tie. They won't be aggressive because they weren't scared of overtime because there was none. So, ladies and gentlemen, that's the story of the 1973-74 Chicago Blackhawks. If you like what we're doing here, give us a like, comment, or subscribe. And don't forget, the early 1970s WHA and the NHL, if you couldn't find a hockey game, you weren't looking. Radio stations were broadcasting approximately 15 to 20 WHA and NHL games per night, literally. Too bad the internet wasn't around back then. Can you imagine the selection? Just tremendous. Anyway, thanks for listening. Bye.